My name is Gil Toombes, and I'm a researcher in Kenton Schwartz's lab at the NIH. I grew up in Brisbane, Australia, and when I was at school, I made a promise to my mother that I'd study at university in Brisbane. So afterwards, I wanted to go as far away as possible. So I came to Cornell University in the United States to study physics for my PhD. And then after that, I went to Paris and worked at the Curie Institute. And then at the end of that time, I came here to the National Institute of Health. I grew up in a big family, and my dad is a science teacher. So my dad was always bringing things home from school. But the thing I loved always was trying to make stuff. And so when we were kids, our dad worked with us and we built a little car using bike parts and wood and a lawnmower engine. And I thought it was really cool to be able to do that. So that got me interested in understanding how things work. I'm a biophysicist, which means that I use physical techniques to study biological questions. In our lab, we study how the venoms have specific toxins which are able to block or activate nerves. My current project is trying to work out why is it that a venom will activate one nerve cell and not another, even though the toxin in the venom is targeting the exact same molecule in both cells. So one difficulty when we're trying to understand why a toxin activates one cell and not another is cells are very complicated. They contain lots of different molecules and their state varies depending on what's going on. So what we're trying to do, our approach to understand this question, is to make the simplest possible cell. Once we have a simple system where the toxin is interacting with its target, then we can make things more complicated. Starting from the ground up, we can add in one component after another to work out which of the interactions or the crucial pair that's making one cell activate and another cell not. I think it's really exciting because hopefully at the end we'll have a system that's so simple we can understand how it works and what the interactions are, but is complicated enough that it will allow us to know why is it that some cells respond to a venom and other cells don't. Every day is a little different. Some days I'm working at the lab bench doing molecular biology to create the new molecules that I want to study. Then other days I'll be mostly at the microscope, looking at the cells and measuring their activity so I can see the interaction between the toxins and the molecules. And then of course there are days when I'm working at the computer trying to analyze the results that I've been able to get. Well, aside from my family, the first person who had a really strong influence on me was Phil O'Neill, my high school science teacher. And the thing that really made a big difference for me with him was that after we had done our work, he would encourage us to take on new challenges. He'd say, I wonder if you can do this, or nobody I know has ever done that. And it was really fun to think that we might be doing something that was totally new or different. Then when I got to university, someone who was a huge help to me was Rod Drury, who directed the Australian Science Olympiads. So every summer I got to work in schools, working with students from high school who wanted to learn physics and other science. And that was really fantastic to get a chance to teach. And a third person who had a huge influence on me was my PhD advisor, Sol Gruner. When I came to the US to study for my PhD, I thought I wanted to do computational physics. I wanted to be able to write down equations and then use the computer to solve and work out what the answer. But when I visited Sol's lab, I saw him using X-rays to study the structure of molecules. And I thought that was really fascinating. And when I talked to Sol, I realized that not only could I do the experiments, but then I could even do some of the modeling and computation myself. And so that was really fantastic to be able to do that. Ask questions. There are lots of different resources you can find, books and information on the internet, but I think one of the best things you can do is to talk to people and ask them about things you're interested in. Talk to your parents, talk to your teachers at school, talk to your parents' friends, talk to your friends. You'll be amazed at all the different places where people are using science. There's science everywhere, and if you ask questions, you're going to be able to find out lots more things than if you just try to stick to a book or if you're not willing to take risks. It's really important to try things that you aren't sure if they're going to work or not. Because when we do science in the lab, the whole point is we don't know what's going to happen. And so it's really important to try things even if you aren't sure how it's going to go. There are lots of great things about being at the NIH. It's a fantastic place to do science. But the thing I like the most is my colleagues. It's really wonderful to be working with people who are absolutely passionate about making new discoveries. And so every day I get to talk to my colleagues about what they're working on, what they've discovered, and tell them about what I'm doing. And that's the thing I love best about working at the NIH.